Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. The government of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago remains committed to protecting jobs and creating employment in our official policy framework. Our concern is that it does not, retrenchment does not become the norm. Madam Speaker, it should be noted that it is difficult at this time to state the actual number of persons who were retrenched or terminated in the public and private sectors from September 7, 2015 to present. However, Madam Speaker, I can share the following information with this Honorable House. 846 workers were identified in retrenchment notices submitted to the Minister of Labor and Small Enterprise Development in accordance with the Retrenchment and Severance Benefits Act, Chapter 8813. Those companies, Madam Speaker, there are 27 in all, totaling 846. And for the information, I will quickly go through the list, Madam Speaker, if time allows me to, without
the contracts of litter wardens have expired. Therefore, the question of termination does not arise. Accordingly, advertisement for the contract positions of litter wardens were placed in the newspaper on February 10th, 12th, and 15th, 2016, and posted on the website of the Ministry of Rural Development and Local Government. Upon receipt of the applications, the customary transparent interview and evaluation process will be conducted, following which all vacancies, and I repeat, all vacancies of litter wardens will be filled.
Only, Madam Speaker, requests for payment made by contractors of and to the Ministry of Works and Transport for work done prior to the general election of September the 7th, 2015, are currently being audited to determine their legitimacy. All legitimate payments will be made as soon as these audits are complete, of course, subject to the availability of cash in order to do so.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. As previously stated, the Coover Hospital will be fully commissioned after all design and construction defects that are likely to affect the proper functioning of the hospital are remedied, and all issues relating to staffing, equipping, outfitting, and operation of this facility are resolved. Honorable members should note that this facility was hastily constructed without the in-depth planning required for its day-to-day operations and without regard for the human and material resources required to operate a complex healthcare facility of this type. As such, Madam Speaker, it will be irresponsible of the government to attempt to operationalize this facility without conducting the required due diligence. Madam Speaker, this fact is underscored by the recent collapse of the ring road around the hospital. Notwithstanding these facts, honorable members are assured that it is this government's intention to operationalize this facility as soon as it is practicable, and in this respect, the ministry is currently exploring all available options, including public-private partnerships. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. There are 260 guidance officers, counselors, providing services in our schools, with one permanently employed officer assigned per school at the secondary level, and one officer supporting four primary schools on a weekly basis. A complement of 134 social workers provide service at a ratio of one officer to five schools at both the primary and the secondary levels. These officers visit schools once per fortnight on a regular basis on referrals by schools and can be accessed easily by way of telephone when the need arises. A complement of 197 staff members provides support for students with special education needs in areas such as screening, assessment, and alternative intervention strategies on a referral basis. Thank you.
Honorable members, I am not satisfied that this matter qualifies under this standing order. I advise that the member pursue this matter under Standing Order 16.
I have been authorized by the Cabinet to make the following statement outlining of the new policy initiatives for the construction of affordable homes by the Housing Development Corporation, HDC. The Ministry of Housing and Urban Development is key to stimulation and diversification of the economy, and more specifically, the construction of affordable housing for those in need. Under the last administration, the private sector had stopped constructing homes. The agency tried to fill the gap left by this sector without success. We will re-energize the sector and continue what past PNM administrations have done, which is the provision of affordable housing. The PNM has been at the forefront of every initiative in public housing in this country since 1956. The National Housing Authority, the NHA, was established in 1962 by the then PNM government to cater for the demand for affordable housing by constructing single and multifamily units in large-scale housing developments for the lower and middle-income groups. During the period 1962 to 1986, the NHA delivered an estimated 25,000 units at an approximate cost of $32,000, at a total cost to the state of $800 million. After the change of government in 1986, over the period 1986 to 1991, because of the different philosophy and approach of public housing of the then NAR government, there was a policy shift from housing construction and towards the provision of service lots. As a result, only a handful of housing units were constructed during the NAR period. When the PNM returned to government in 1991, the NHA resumed construction of houses, but this effort was once again stymied under the UNC administration of 1995 to 2001, when the focus shifted away again from housing construction to land development. When the government changed again in 2001, the incoming PNM government revived the NHA and housing construction resumed. In order to better execute its mandate, the NHA was subsequently transformed into the agency, which focused on one, project management of new housing construction, two, facility management of its existing rental and new stock. The agency then developed and implemented the New Way Home Housing Program, which yielded approximately 15,746 housing units at an estimated unit price of $351,539, which cost the state roughly $5,535,000,000. $332,548. In comparison, during the 2010 to 2015 period under the PP government, the agency produced only 3,890 units, with an estimated unit cost of $1,388,179. Almost four times the unit cost of a housing unit under the PNM government from 2001 to 2010. The overall cost to the state over the last 5 years was around $5,400,017,071. The state, Madam Speaker, cannot sustain this level of funding for the housing sector due to the current economic downturn, nor can it continue to pay inflated prices for housing. Moreover, the agency continues to face challenges in satisfying the increasing demand for housing. The government has adopted a new prescriptive approach, a new paradigm shift in the construction industry, which is a public-private sector partnership approach. To operationalize this new initiatives, certain steps will be taken by the agency. One, we will invite expressions of interest. An invitation would be extended to the private sector, that's land developers and contractors, for their involvement in the government's housing program. The objective is to harness the large sums of money available in the private sector by encouraging private individuals with access to funds to invest in the housing program, which will result in a greater earning on their investment. Two, to assess area or sites offered for development. The agency will assess the suitability of both state and private lands for housing development. Three, identification of applicants for mortgages. The agency will review and identify its housing application database to identify applicants who are willing and able to sustain a mortgage. The selected applicants were then referred to the TTMF or Home Mortgage Bank for pre-qualification of mortgage loans. Four, the provision of model houses. The contractors or developers will make available models of various house types for display. The contractors or developers will be invited to competitively bid using the HDC's conceptual designs as a guide. Five, ensuring fairness in pricing arrangements. The agency will ensure that the pricing arrangements with contractors or developers will be undertaken in a manner to achieve value for money through competition and fairness within the program. Six, provision of oversight services. The agency will provide oversight services to monitor all steps of the housing community construction. Seven, ensuring that contractors and developers are paid upon completion of the projects. The agency will ensure that contractors and developers are paid from the housing program pool of mortgage funds upon completion of their projects. Finalization of payments will be made within 2 months of the submission of the completion certificate of the project. Eight, ensuring the submission of completion certificates and titles by developers. The agency will ensure that proper title for the properties and completion certificates are produced by the developers at the handover of keys to previously identified applicants who have pre-qualified for the program. Nine, ensuring the execution of mortgages. The agency will ensure that new homeowners execute their respective mortgages in a timely manner to ensure continuity of the program. Steps to be taken by the TTMF or the Home Mortgage Bank. One, the TTMF will begin the pre-qualification process with the applicants who have been selected from the HDC's database. Two, they will collect initial deposit as required for mortgage loans from pre-qualified applicants. And three, they will finalize payment for houses with land developer contractors within 2 months of submission of the completion certificate or a certificate of practical completion. This approach, Madam Speaker, will foster the development of smaller housing communities where private sector lands could be identified for housing development. It will address the agency's applicants' requests for homes in specific areas. It will stimulate the economy, something which the last regime failed to actualize during the last 5 years. It will generate ripple effects throughout the economy through the multiplier effect, especially in terms of job creation and revenue. Companies of all sizes will indirectly or directly derive business from the construction industry. And finally, Madam Speaker, of paramount importance is that the funding for this project will be provided via the private sector, thus reducing the burden on the public purse. This is the way forward, Madam Speaker.